Have you ever tried talking to your dog?
Here, Fido.
Pretty cute, isn't it? It's amazing how much they can understand.
Slippers. Arf, arf, arf.
They even seem to feel your mood or know when something's wrong. It can sometimes feel like they're your best friend. When they look at you with those eyes, it's almost like they could talk to you. Almost.
Mm-hmm.
Except not quite.
Yeah.
In fact, not really like that at all. You can get a feel for them, sure. There's definitely communication going on. Just not very much. At best, it's like talking to a young baby. Try explaining that you're going to have to leave them for a few minutes. And here's the thing. It's not just your dog that can't understand when you try to explain something. Even just the simplest thing, let alone the offside rule or quantum physics. They just don't get it. Not dogs, not cats, not pigs, not ponies. In fact, not any of the other million or so species we know we share our planet with. None of them, not one single one, can speak to us. That's not to say that other species can't communicate with each other. All animals can show their feelings to some extent. They do that with sound, posture, smell, changes of color, even electricity. They can threaten a rival, warn each other of danger, or show their children how to do things. But they can't have a conversation. They can't talk. Only humans can do that. When you think about it, that's pretty weird, right? Why should it be just us? Well, here's the really weird thing. We have absolutely no idea. What? The very thing that makes us so different to other animals? Language? The tool that's given us everything from social media to robots on Mars? And we have no idea where it comes from? Seriously? Yep, it's official. A few years back, Professor Noam Chomsky, the man who more or less invented modern linguistics, declared the origin of language to be a mystery. And not just a mystery we can solve, like a puzzle. A permanent, eternal mystery. So as things stand, we really don't know why humans are able to talk and dogs aren't. As in, we have no idea at all. None whatsoever. Nada. Given how important language is to us, that's almost off the scale weird. Without it, you wouldn't be here listening to me. Without words, you'd be running wild in the woods, scratching around for food. Naked, probably. But then, for most of human history, not knowing wasn't really a problem. Like the air we breathe, we just took it for granted. And if we did think about it, there was always some kind of religious answer. God gave us language so we could rule over the animals and all of nature, right? Well, that all took a tumble in 1859, when Charles Darwin published a book called On the Origin of Species. In it, he claimed that all the different animals on planet Earth could just have evolved naturally and didn't need a god to make them or give them special skills. That caused a huge storm. People argued that only God could create something as wonderful as a man, or a woman, though they were less worried about that then. But the jury is now in. The fossil evidence is overwhelming, and we know he was right. Even the Vatican agrees that evolution is a fact. So what about language? Pretty soon after Darwin went public, people started coming up with theories. There was the Bow Wow theory, the Ding Dong theory, the La La theory, the Poo Poo theory, even the Yo Hee Ho theory. Check it out, I'm not making this up. But there was a big problem. Unlike bodies and bones, language leaves no obvious fossils. There was no evidence to support any of these theories, and never likely to be any. So in 1866, the prestigious Linguistic Society of Paris banned all discussion of the subject on the grounds that it was a waste of time, and the rest of the world agreed. So that was it for about 100 years, until Professor Chomsky had a better idea. He said that since only humans can talk, our big brains must have evolved a special faculty to do so, which he called a language acquisition device, or LAD. According to him, there must have been some genetic mutation unique to Homo sapiens, which gave us the cognitive capacity to be able to start talking. And that would be why your dog can't talk, or cat, or pig, or pony. Their brains just aren't big enough. They can't have abstract thoughts, use grammar, or think symbolically, because they don't have the smarts to do that. Simples. But wait a moment. Why did our ancestors grow such big brains in the first place? Good question. Glad you asked. But guess what? We actually don't have an answer to that either, which is super weird given how important our brains seem to be. And there's something weirder still. People who study fossils know that just as our brains were getting bigger, our bodies were getting weaker, and our jaws smaller, and we became slimmer, what anthropologists call gracile. That's really strange, as this was happening just when we'd have been needing more food to build our growing brains. A lot more food, in fact. So how can we explain that? Well, perhaps that's when we started using language. Being able to talk, even very simply, means that a group can slowly start to organize itself and become stronger than any individual. Having a way to share ideas allows us to pool our intelligence so that everyone in our community can benefit from the best ideas. That would certainly have created an evolutionary pressure for bigger, smarter brains. But how could an early human with a brain the size of a chimpanzee have started to use language? When we've tried teaching chimps to talk, we've not had much luck. They learn a few words, but not much else. Certainly no grammar. But maybe like them, early humans didn't need grammar. Maybe the first step on the road to language was much simpler than we've thought. Let's go back to dogs and think about what's different between what they do and how we talk. Dogs have many ways to show how they feel: a bark, a yelp, a growl, a whine, and can modify these sounds to suit their feeling. It can be a scary bark, or a scared one, a yelp of pain, or a yelp of pleasure, a threatening growl, or a playful one. But do they bark in sentences? Are the yelps words? No, they're noises, pure and simple. They're just single, unique sounds that can't be divided up, only adjusted for tone, volume, and feeling. In other words, they're analog sounds. Simple noises that have meaning can vary in intensity and quality, but otherwise do not change. Words are different. They're sounds too, but they're made of smaller sounds. These smaller bits are vowels and consonants, the noises that linguists call phonemes. The word dog is made of three phonemes: d, o, and g. Reverse them, and you get God. A very different, quite unrelated meaning. All words are like this, and that's what makes them so different. Where animal noises are analog, words are digital. Digital? Yes, digital. Think of numbers. With just 10 different digits, we can write any number we want, because we use them as part of a system. You know exactly what I mean by the 1,348, without having a new name for each number along the way. It's the same with phonemes. Just by combining a few different noises, you can make as many words as you want. And that's the crucial switch. It's the key to what's known as digital infinity. Suddenly, it's easy to create tens of thousands of words, sounds that are easier to remember because they're systematic. The reason animals can't talk isn't because they aren't smart enough to understand grammar. They can't talk because they don't have enough words to need it. Without words, grammar can't get started. The idea that language began with a shift from analog to digital communication probably can't be proved without a time machine, but it matches what we know of how words work. And it does make a number of predictions. The first is that it would favor an increase in brain power and size, and that is what we see. Second, we'd expect the number of phonemes to drop away as languages evolve through time, and we see that too. We know that languages with the most phonemes have the oldest pedigree, and the languages with the fewest are found furthest from Africa. And thirdly, if language began by combining sounds that were already being used to communicate, you'd expect to find other species doing it too. And guess what? We do. We already know that species as different as Campbell's monkeys, prairie dogs, and pied babblers create new meanings using existing calls. So there's hope for dogs yet. But here's the thing. The transition from early speech to full-blown language wouldn't have happened overnight. It probably took hundreds of thousands, even millions of years, as our brains slowly grew to adapt to it. But because we humans got there first, that gives us an enormous advantage. That's because language isn't just another small step along the evolutionary road, like eyes, toes, or color vision. It's a complete game changer. Language links up our brains, which means we're no longer alone, struggling to work out everything on our own. We can tap into a vast body of knowledge that grows with every generation, spread further in turn through writing, then printing, and now the internet. That's totally liberating, even as it traps us with the false gods of culture, religion, and identity. But that's another story. A story which you can read all about in my new book, Speech: The Hitherto Untold Tale of How Language Made Us Human. And who wouldn't want to know about that? Available now via the link below. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed the show.